Welcome to the MCTV Live News Update. Thanks for joining us tonight. I'm Kevin Bruckner.
And I'm Nadia Ahmed. Sit back while we take you through the news that's hitting the world right now. Let's jump right into tonight's top story. China launched its first ever robotic lunar rover early Monday morning. The country hopes to be the third in history to have a successful soft landing on the moon. Known as Jade Rabbit, or U2 in Chinese, the rover has the ability to dig through and gather lunar soil for future analysis. The mission also has gained the attention of former moonwalker Buzz Aldrin. He encourages the U.S. to communicate with China about lunar exploration. The spacecraft is expected to land in mid-December inside the crater known as the right eye of the man of the moon.
Bangkok is seeing a lot of violence recently. This past Sunday, anti-government protests led to a shooting and the death of at least three people. Over 100 are wounded because of the week-long protests. The two sides of the conflict are very similar to the rebel protests in Syria. The demonstrators are focusing in on critical government buildings and trying to put an end to the current governmental system. They are frustrated with the former prime minister's reign and alliance with the Thai countryside. They are proposing a system that would be made up of People's Council formed from representatives of different professions.
In London, the murder trial is underway for two men accused in a gruesome killing that happened right in front of the stunned onlookers. They watched as British soldier Lee Rigby was hit by a car outside his barracks and then hacked to death. The two men accused pleaded not guilty, and yesterday the court saw a cell phone video taken at the scene where one of the defendants said Rigby was killed because Muslims are getting killed by British soldiers every day. CNN's Atika Schubert reports.
Well, some more harrowing details were revealed in court today. More CCTV video that showed the defendant's car hitting Lee Rigby and throwing him to the pavement. There was also more video which showed him being dragged from the pavement to the middle of the road. When this video was shown in court, Lee Rigby's fiancée and his family looked down. They eventually left the courtroom because it was simply too much to take. The jury then heard from several eyewitnesses, including one eyewitness who was closest to the attack. In her written statement, she says that she saw the two defendants hacking at Lee Rigby with, quote, considerable force. Clearly a very traumatic experience for many of those witnesses. In fact, one of the witnesses, James Hennigan, described how he came upon the scene and initially thought it was a car accident. So he got out of his car to help, but instead of seeing the men, the defendants there helping the victim, he says he saw them hacking at Lee Rigby and that Lee Rigby wasn't moving at all. When he tried to get them to stop, he says they pointed a gun at him. He was clearly very traumatized in the dock today, and it was clearly a very difficult time for the friends and family of Lee Rigby to hear this, but the prosecution is continuing to make its case and will continue with more eyewitnesses tomorrow. Atika Schubert, CNN, London.
It has been 1 year since Mexican President Enrique Nieto took office, promising Mexico many economic and social reforms. Unfortunately, less than half of the voters in the country approve of his performance. According to a poll released on Sunday, safety remains a concern for many in and around Mexico City. One local reported being robbed and received threatening extortion calls. It is not the Mexico his president depicted. Nieto recently joined forces with a left-wing party in order to increase taxes. He plans to continue with his plans despite opposition.
For the first time in over 200 years, Iceland's police have fatally shot a person. CNN iReporter Hal Sigurdsson was on his way to work when he captured the video yesterday in Reykjavik Island, Iceland. He says he drove by the neighborhood where the person was fatally wounded by police. With a population of about 320,000 people, Iceland is known for its low crime rate, he says. Sigurdsson says he is shocked that this happened in Iceland.
Growing up, all of our parents warned us about the dangers of eating watermelon seeds, but one little girl in Shanghai didn't have a watermelon growing inside her. She had a dandelion. According to Beijing Morning Post, the 16-month-old girl had been scratching at her ear for months. Turns out she had a seed somehow got stuck in her ear, and by the time doctors found it, it had blossomed into the flower. The dandelion had to be removed right away. If there was too much pressure, the eardrum could burst and cause internal bleeding. This is not the only weird object to be found in ears recently. In July, a woman in Peru had an ear full of flesh-eating worms, and last year, a woman in China found a spider dwelling in her ear canal. I don't know about you, but spiders creep me out, and flesh-eating worms don't sound any better. I'd rather be the girl with the dandelion. What do you think?
I mean, just the thought of spiders or any kind of insect growing in your ears kind of gives me the chills.
Yeah, absolutely.
When we come back, a look into the tragic death of the Fast and Furious star, Paul Walker.
And an update on some of the games you might have missed this Thanksgiving weekend. All that and more when we return.
I guess this is it.
You promised to call?
I promise. Hey, Dad.
Hey, Kelsey, how's school?
Everything's great. I really like my classes.
There are so many clubs and activities to choose from. I think I'd like to study abroad. I was accepted for an internship in New York City. I can't believe I'm graduating.
My name is Brittany, and I'm a freshman at Marist College. It was one of my first weeks on campus, and some friends and I decided to go out. After a few hours, thinking nothing of it, I decided to leave early. That night, I was brutally attacked because I decided to leave the bar alone. It took one night, one bad decision, that would create pain for a lifetime.
Welcome back. I'm very sad to report that Paul Walker has passed away in a car crash this past Saturday. We will go to Martha Shade in a bit to talk more about the passing of the beloved Fast and Furious star. But first, in other celebrity news, Kanye West released his video Bound 2 off the Yeezus album starring Kim Kardashian. And although audiences may have been shocked by its explicit content, it made for a great parody. When Seth Rogen and James Franco decided to do a shot-for-shot remake, everyone was applauding. Kardashian even loved it, tweeting, "You nailed it, so funny." In TV news, audiences were not only shocked by the death of Brian, the famous dog in Family Guy, they were angry and appalled. According to Steve Callahan, one of the show's producers, it was just an idea that was brought up by the writers and they went with it. However, the devoted Family Guy fans are protesting the show. Callahan claims the series needed a change, and it was easier to kill off the dog than one of the kids. That's more shocking than the latest episode of The Walking Dead. For all you Christian Grey fans out there, you'll be happy to know that after the delay in filming the big screen adaptation of the erotic book series 50 Shades of Grey, despite production setbacks, the anticipated drama is set to hit theaters this February. I'm sure there'll be quite the Valentine's Day treat for both men and women. Moving on to movies that are actually out in theaters right now, The Hunger Games obviously trumped any competition it might have had this opening weekend. The second film, Catching Fire, blew away audiences just as much as the first Hunger Games film. And this winter, I expect a ton of great movies to see, some of which being American Hustle, Out of the Furnace, Saving Mr. Banks, and That Awkward Moment. Keep an eye out for those trailers. Another film that I'm happy to say is not slowing down due to the recent death of its lead actor, Paul Walker, is the movie Hours. This drama takes place in the middle of Katrina as a mother gives birth and a father finds himself desperate to find help. The film is set to release in select theaters on December 13th. I'm Brittany Jelinski, keeping you in the know. Now let's go to Martha Shade with Paul Walker's obituary.
Paul Walker, the star of the Fast and the Furious franchise, died in a fiery car crash in Valencia, California. A second person also died in the accident. According to his representative, the star was not behind the wheel when the Porsche hit something and exploded in flames. The car crash happened around 3:30 p.m. just north of Los Angeles. Walker wasn't just a car enthusiast on the silver screen. Off-screen, the actor competed in the Redline Time Attack racing series. Walker had been filming the latest installment of The Fast and the Furious at the time of his death. The actor is survived by his 15-year-old daughter, Meadow. I'm Martha Shade reporting.
If you like close games between bitter rivals, then this weekend of college football was for you. Number 1-ranked Alabama paid a visit to number 4-ranked Auburn for a game that would feature one of the most unique endings in college football history. The score tied at 28 in the final seconds of the fourth quarter. Auburn's Chris Davis returned a missed field goal attempt by Alabama more than 100 yards for a touchdown, as time expired to give Auburn a 34-28 win. As a result, Alabama dropped to 4th in the rankings while Auburn jumped to 3rd, and Florida State became the new number 1. The team sandwiched in between them at 2nd, Ohio State, with an exciting rivalry game of their own on Saturday, when they paid a visit to Ann Arbor to face Michigan. The bad blood between these two longtime rivals was clear throughout the whole game, but it reached its boiling point in the second quarter when a brawl between the teams broke out. Two Ohio State players and one Michigan player were ejected from the game as a result. Ohio State ended up winning 42-41 after Michigan failed a two-point conversion attempt in the final seconds that would have given them a lead and likely the win. The Buckeyes will put their perfect 12-0 season on the line in the Big Ten title game against Michigan State. To the NFL now, the Giants earned a 24-17 victory over the Washington Redskins in D.C. on Sunday night. Eli Manning completed 22 of his 28 pass attempts for 235 yards with a touchdown and interception. Big Blue's record improved to 5-7 with the win, but their playoff hopes still appear to be pretty dim. Speaking of dim playoff hopes, the Jets suffered their third loss in a row on Sunday, this one by a score of 23-3 at home at the hands of the Miami Dolphins. Miami quarterback Ryan Tannehill completed 28 of 43 pass attempts for 331 yards and 2 touchdowns. The bigger story, though, is that Jets rookie quarterback Geno Smith was pulled from the game in favor of backup Matt Sims after a string of poor games. It'll be interesting to see if Smith can hold on to a starting job for the 5-7 Jets. Finally tonight, the New York Knicks continued to struggle on Sunday as they lost the New Orleans Pelicans 103-99. The Knicks' record fell to 3-13 with the loss. If you ask me, Mike Woodson's days as head coach are numbered. That's all for this week. I'm Michael Sachs, giving you all you need to know to keep your head in the game. When we return, our own Katie Johnson has the inside scoop on the band Far From Proper, who got to start performing at venues like The Chance in Poughkeepsie. See you back here soon.
Why should the people watch the other half? Phenomenal question.
We really get down to the issues.
Oh!
Now it's trendy, it's hilarious.
It's something that every college student can relate to.
It gets very provocative.
4, 3, 2. Really great to see what the opposite sex thinks about things.
Real men don't do that, alright? You gotta start seeing some real men.
Okay!
You know, there's some times where Rob and I have a little bit of a disagreement on subjects. Final thought.
Oh my god. I look jacked.
No. We do episodes on fashion, sports, text translation, first dates.
It's just an international sensation that this show is going to be sweeping the nation.
Let it out, it's a fiasco.
Really, every college student in the world should be watching this show.
Low five. No.
Welcome back, everyone. Joining me here tonight are a few members of the band Far From Proper, a punk rock band that started by playing local venues such as The Chance in downtown Poughkeepsie. They've recently returned from touring the country to play again at the venue that they hold dear. On their Facebook page, they describe themselves as honest, positive, and fun. We've invited them tonight to talk to us about where they came from, where they're going, and who to look out for in the local music scene. Thanks for joining us tonight, guys.
You're welcome.
So first off, I just wanted to ask, how did you guys get your start as a band?
Well, I think it's 6 years now, almost. Our guitarist Matt and I went to high school together. We were both in the same class, and towards the end of our sophomore year, we wanted to cover a Paramore song for the ballad band. So I knew our other guitarist, Angelo, from grade school. So we asked him to play, and we had a couple other people. And then about 4 months later, Nick hit us up through MySpace, and wanted to sing because he knew Matt from a theater camp from a few years earlier. So from that, and it's been the four of us.
And well, you guys have come a long way. And I heard you recently finished up a tour.
Yeah.
the country?
We did about 3.5 weeks out to the Midwest. We didn't get all the way out yet, but that one went all the way out through about Indiana, Tennessee, and places like that, and came all the way back up through the coast. So it was a lot of fun.
Yeah, and do you think that playing at places like the Chance and Poughkeepsie have influenced your music at all? Seeing shows
like sonically, I wouldn't say so much like our sound, but they definitely have propelled us to a new place. I started going to local shows probably about 8 years ago, and Poughkeepsie's always had a great local scene, and we've always had a really awesome, strong following that just keeps getting better.
What do you think the biggest difference between playing in front of a small crowd in Poughkeepsie and going on tour and playing in places you've never been before?
I think when you play at home, for the most part, we're playing to a lot of our friends, a lot of kids we've met from playing shows, and it's just kind of a sense of community that we always know we're going to get when we come home, as opposed to when we're on the road, where there's still a community, but it's basically you have to prove yourself every night because you're playing to people who don't know who you are, who may not care. So you basically have 30 minutes a night to make them care.
Yeah, no, I saw you guys play twice last summer, actually,
awesome.
And just seeing all the fans, you guys definitely developed a following in the local area, so that was really cool to see. It was definitely high energy feel. And I guess the other thing I wanted to ask you is, who mainly writes your songs in the band?
I think the cool thing about our band is that I know there's a lot of bands that have, like, one main songwriter, but that's never been the case with us, especially not recently. I write a lot of guitar parts. Angela writes a lot of guitar parts. Matt writes guitar parts. Jesse doesn't even play guitar and he writes guitar parts. So, like, we're all very, it's all like a collective group effort. And, like, some songs may have more someone's influence on them than others. But at the end of the day, every song is 25% each of us, you know.
And would you say that there's a favorite venue that you guys have to play at, or
home? Obviously, the Loft. I mean, a lot. I love the Chance, the sound, but it's very impersonal. The Loft is very, you know, intimate and very small. So that one's probably our favorite from home. I think my favorite from the road, probably either Uncle Lou's in Orlando, or Transitions Art Gallery, which is now called Epic Problem in Tampa, Florida. We have a lot of friends in Florida, so our shows down there are awesome.
And I understand you guys have a show coming up in December?
Yes. We are playing the Loft stage in a two-stage festival called Fire and Ice Festival at the Chance on December 14th.
Okay, I'm excited. Me and my friend will be going to that one, so
awesome.
I'm looking
Sweet.
Forward to it. But, yeah, so, well, it looks like that's all the time we have for tonight. Make sure to check out Far From Proper's music on their website and like them on Facebook. To order tickets to their upcoming show on the 14th, click on the link on their Facebook page. And when we come back, we will head to Emily Cescitelli with an outlook on the rainy week ahead. We'll be back after this.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to Red Fox TV.
When should I be expecting you? 15 minutes? I'll be ready.
Back. Looking south, major rainfall is hitting Cuba. Saturday started the torrential downpour that flooded many areas. Even though hurricane season is over, this slow-moving storm has hit the island and in some cases caused damage to homes. Many said they could not remember the last time there was this much rain. Weather storm Cleon has been driving down temperatures. Descending down on us from Canada, this winter storm is bringing lots of snow and cold to the Salt Lake and Great Lake region of the country. In some mountainous areas, forecasts say there could be over a foot of snow by tomorrow. That's enough about what's happening for weather around the world. Let's see what's happening in our own backyards. As the semester is coming to a close, we are experiencing some cooler December weather, just in time for our Christmas break. Today, we had warmer days with temperatures around 48 degrees with partly cloudy skies. For tonight, temperatures are going to drop down to about 28 degrees for a mostly clear night. Tomorrow is looking much like today did with temperatures around 47 degrees and partly cloudy skies. For tomorrow night, you can expect temperatures around 38 degrees, and your weather for the late week is looking promising with temperatures in the high 40s, but a chance of rain, so keep a lookout for that. For your weekend, temperatures are going to drastically drop with highs in the high 30s and cloudy skies with freezing rain. Careful on the roads with this kind of weather. Black ice is cause for scary driving conditions. Next week is also going to be cold, just in time for final exams. Hopefully you can stay snug and warm while studying hard, Marist. Now let's check the almanac. December 3rd has had some pretty drastic highs and lows over the years. The record high for December 3rd was set back in 1998 with a temperature of 64 degrees. The record low was set back in 1976 with a temperature of only 4 degrees. I'm not a fan of cold weather personally, so I'm content with these high 40s we're experiencing now. I have no interest in 4-degree days. So what do you guys think? Will we have a white Christmas here in New York? The record highs and lows in Christmases past are 63 degrees set back in 1964 and negative 13 degrees set back in 1980. This is anyone's guess for year 2013, so keep your fingers crossed, folks. Keep your fingers crossed, folks, and just maybe we'll have a picturesque snow-covered Christmas. That's all I have for you here. With your highs and lows report, I'm Emily Cescitelli. When we come back, we'll look into the Metro North train derailment, as well as some shocking news from this past Thanksgiving weekend. See you back here in a bit.
Yeah, I got the money. I'll be there soon.
We must do that which we think we cannot.
The mind is everything. What you think, you become.
It is not best that we should all think alike.
He who learns but does not think is lost.
The main purpose of life is to live rightly, think rightly, act rightly.
Oh, the things you could think up if only you try.
Holiday season progresses, one man spread holiday cheer in a unique way. On Black Friday at the Mall of America in Minnesota, Serge Varobiav threw $1,000 off of the fourth floor balcony as a choir sang Let It Snow. Each dollar was stamped with his YouTube address. Varobiav said he has been going through a rough year, losing his wife, his business, his cat, and his car. He was arrested for disorderly conduct in the mall, but he said it was worth it.
A new shopping tradition has made its way into Dutchess County, giving big box stores some unexpected competition this weekend. Small Business Saturday, a fairly new holiday created by American Express, arrived at Beacon's own Main Street. The idea of Saturday shopping is to encourage customers to spend money at their local mom and pop businesses. Many shoppers are searching for good deals, and the Small Business Saturday alternative offers just that. Fewer crowds and no all-night shopping expeditions are all allowing local employees to spend more time on Thanksgiving with their families.
The things you buy online could soon be delivered by drones. When you buy stuff on Amazon.com, you could soon have it at your doorstep through a new delivery service called Prime Air. Amazon hopes to have unmanned drones, which look like toy helicopters, deliver packages to your doorstep.
In an interview on 60 Minutes, Amazon CEO Jeff Bezos said the drones will be ready in 4 or 5 years. FAA rule changes could make the flights legal as soon as 2015. The octocopters Amazon would use are currently in testing. They can only carry packages which weigh up to 5 pounds, but Amazon says 90% of the packages it delivers weigh less than that.
Senator Mitch McConnell is encouraging Republicans to stand their ground in the aftermath of the government shutdown. In a recent interview, he said that they need to stand up to those who are afraid of conservatism. McConnell specifically singled out the Senate Conservatives Fund, saying groups of that nature are giving the party a bad name. He believes that these groups are misleading their donors by ruling out a fact that Democratic administration may have had more to do with the lack of an outcome than the Republican Party alone.
The U.S. government's new healthcare website, healthcare.gov, has been improved to become faster and more user-friendly, but still has many glitches with its client registration system. Insurance companies have complained that there is a glitch that prevents them from receiving their clients' registration information. The companies have also received incomplete or incorrect registration information from the site. The government will be working to fix the problems with the enrollment portion of the site in the coming weeks.
U.S. Customs and Border Protection arrested two men on Monday in a major marijuana bust. The two are allegedly responsible for 260 pounds of marijuana that fell from an aircraft near Brownfield Airport in San Diego. The large bundle was found attached to a metal cage used to hold cargo in a nearby field. According to reports, the plane crossed into U.S. territory shortly after 4 a.m., dropping several heavy bundles of weed before escaping back across the border. Sources say the bundle is valued at $170,000. The pilot remains under investigation.
Marist's own Lower New Fulton resident staff hosted a fall festival in their courtyard on November 24th. The highlight of the day was a petting zoo with llamas, chickens, alpacas, and even a pony. For those brave enough, a pie-eating contest had all of Lower Fulton chanting and cheering. Despite the below-freezing temperatures, residents enjoyed activities such as fall-themed photo booth and a pumpkin weight guessing contest. The event was a great way for students to have a little fun before the end of the semester.
So if you're looking for a little bit of fun before finals, this Saturday night, Mahoney's Pub in Poughkeepsie will be hosting Rock for Refugees, a benefit concert to support Syrian refugees. Organized by Marist College student Janine Starr, the event will raise money for Oxfam, America's Syria Relief Fund. Expect performances from the Celtic band Makana, featuring Marist professor Colin McCann, along with a 90s Green Day cover band, Walking Contradiction. Anyone over the age of 21 can attend. For more information, you can visit the Facebook event page, Rock for Refugees Oxfam Benefit.
4 people are dead and over 60 injured after a Metro North train derailed in the Bronx on Sunday. Among the survivors was the train engineer. He said that when he tried to apply the brakes at a sharp turn, the train did not react. The National Transportation Safety Board is currently investigating the cause of the crash. 2 black box recorders have been recovered from the site. Investigators are looking at data indicating the speed of the train and how the brakes were applied. Both the conductor and the engineer are expecting to be interviewed further.
A town banded together this past Friday to help the victims of a plane crash in southwestern Alaska. 4 lives were taken as a result of the crash, but the real story here is that a mother of one of the victims, an infant, traveled through the night to find authorities and get help. The Cessna 208 was carrying 10 passengers at the time of the crash. By the time authorities and help arrived on the scene, members from the town had already started efforts to sift through the wreckage and recover those involved. With daylight savings time over, the amount of daylight hours in the area are lessening and flight conditions are becoming more hazardous. It's always awful hearing stories like this. I know this hits close to home, certainly with me. My mother's a flight attendant, so this is something I used to worry about growing up, but you know, this is supposed to be the safest mode of transportation, you know.
Yeah, it's definitely a scary thought hearing about all these plane crashes that happen worldwide. I know recently there was one in Russia as well, and for a frequent flyer like myself as well, it's definitely frightening to
exactly.
think about. Looks like that's all we have for you tonight. MCTV News Live will be back next semester. Until then, I'm Nadia Ahmed.
And I'm Kevin Bruckner. Have a wonderful winter break. And remember, stay foxy, Marist.